All right, y'all, let's kick this thing off. Before we kick it off, the first thing we're going to do is everyone grab their phone.
Enrique, I forgot my phone.
Great. You're good. Everyone grab their phone. If you have a little button that makes it go on silent on the side, put it on silent. Or if you could change your setting to silent. And then the next thing you're going to do is you're going to take it, you're going to put it face down. Or put it in your bag or put it face down where it's not going to distract you. We don't have a lot of time, guys. This is only from 11:30 to about 1 o'clock. We want to make sure, you know, it's short, sweet, impactful. We want to make sure we get the most out of it. And then we'll have some lunch, some networking at the end. But first off, I want to just welcome everybody. Thank you guys for making it out here. It's raining. Weather's crazy. Raise your hand if you didn't feel like getting out of bed this morning. You saw the rain and you were just kind of like, yeah, I don't know. I mean, I know I was. I was battling a little bit. But we made it. And I want to acknowledge everybody for getting up today and making it over here, right? You had to do what you had to do. You had to get ready. Some of you guys have kids. Some of you guys have significant others. Some of you guys traveled. Some of you guys came from where? Los Baños. Los Baños. Let's go. In the rain. But I think we got to talk about that, guys. I think we have to acknowledge the fact that everybody showed up today, because showing up is the first step, right? And if you showed up today, because there are some people that didn't show up, just FYI, if you showed up, then what that tells me is that you are taking your business serious, right? You are seeing the value in showing up today. You're seeing the value in taking some time out of your workday to work on your business, right? We spend a lot of time working in our business where we're serving clients, making calls, doing all those things, emails, etc. But this is your time to really go deep and work on your business so you can set up your future. So I want to start off with just posing a question to you guys and also let you know that this is going to be an interactive workshop, right? It's not going to be me talking the whole time. It's going to be me leading the discussion and Jason, but there's going to be a lot of interaction between you guys because if it's just me talking, you know, that might be a little bit boring. And I want to make sure you guys will have a lot of good ideas, right? You guys might be able to brainstorm or point things out, or you might be able to make an impact on the person next to you. So just make sure we're participating, guys. So I want to pose this first question. We're going to start off with this. And I got this question. I was listening to a podcast earlier today with Brendan Burchard and Ed Milet. If anybody knows who Brendan Burchard is, he's like a motivational guy. But he says he meets with Oprah. Like he's part of like a group with Oprah. He meets with her often. And he said, every single time I meet with Oprah, before we start the meeting, she says, what is the intention of this meeting? And what are we looking to accomplish today? That's how the meeting starts. It isn't like, let's just dive in and start getting to work. It's starting the meeting with an intention. So the question that I want to pose to you guys is the same question, right? Is what is the intention of this business planning workshop? I want to make sure that we're clear on that. And I also want to make sure that there's a goal, right? The end goal in mind. After you leave this, what are you looking to gain, right? What's the purpose of it? So real quick, grab the person next to you and we'll spend 1 minute, just discuss what's the intention of today's workshop and what is the goal? What are you looking to accomplish by the end or walk away with? Let's go.
I'm going to go to the next slide.
All right, let's wrap it up, guys. Let's wrap it up. Let's wrap it up. Let's wrap it up. Got a lot of stuff to go through. I think I need a mic. Hit the bell, hit the bell. All right, guys, let's wrap it up real quick. Let's move on. Really quick, I need two people to raise their hand. Did someone else tell you something that was like, oh, that's a really good way to look at it? Not what you said, right? A lot of times we won't share what we said, but we'll share what someone else said. So raise your hand if you were talking to someone and they told you what it meant to them or what the intention was, and you were like, that sounded pretty good. That sounded pretty cool. Or that sounded crystal clear. Raise your hand and share what someone else said. I need two volunteers. Anything that stood out to you? Yeah, at least 50 people in the room, guys. I need two people. Two people.
Be brave.
Let's go. All right, what did you say then? If you could share what you said then.
Me, I want to walk out with a written plan and new motivation to go out and execute in my business.
I like that.
And okay. I like the energy in this one.
Yeah, let's go. All right, a written plan and a new motivation to execute in your business. That was really good, actually. Really well said. Anybody else? What's it mean to you? Why do you create a business plan? What are you hoping to accomplish out of this? One volunteer. I'm going to call on someone. Roscoe. All right.
Perfect. You set up blinders and be focused.
Set up blinders and be focused. What does set up blinders mean?
Lots of things that happen in your life that can derail you from your plan or path. So something to get you back on track.
Yes. Yes. I like that. Setting up blinders, right? Blinders is like horses, right? They have the little blinders so that they continue just to look forward and they don't keep going that way and this way. Because we know that being in business, it's really easy to get distracted, right? Because life is constantly happening, right? Like we have this plan. Hey, I want to do this. I want to close these deals. And then life starts laughing at you. It's like, yeah, but I got this plan for you over here, right? And you're trying to go and it's easy to get off track, right? So what it means to me, the purpose of this business plan is to really set a roadmap, like some of you guys said, to make sure we have the blinders on and to also make sure we have a reference point that we can go back to during the times that we do get distracted, because we are going to get distracted. Like just bottom line, you're going to get distracted. Things are going to happen. You're going to start off with the plan right now and tomorrow or a month from now or 3 months from now, something is going to happen that is going to derail you from the plan that you set out, you know, to accomplish today. It's just the way life works, guys. So for us to go into this thinking that nothing is going to distract us or we're not going to get derailed, like we're foolish, right, to think that. So just we have to accept that and go into it thinking we have to put this plan in place. We need to have something we can go back to in case we get lost, mm-hmm. Right? If you're trying to jump in a car and travel from here to New York without a map, it's going to be pretty freaking hard, right? I'm sure you could figure it out. You might be able to call someone. You might be able to just look at the freeway signs, or you might just, you know, all right, just go, you know, what is it, east, right? But you're probably going to get derailed somewhere or another, right? And you're not going to get to New York as fast as you would have if you just had a map, a Google map, a plan, a reference point, a check-in, all those things. You're going to get there a lot faster. So the purpose of a business plan, it's not like this is going to create like some magic thing in your business where you're like, all right, business plan, boom, my business changed. You still got to do the work, right? You still have to do the work, but you're doing the work with the roadmap. You're doing the work with the reference point. You're doing the work with something you can go back to when you're not sure if you're on track, when you're not sure what you should be focusing on. And I know for us, like in our journey in business, almost 20 years now, there have been many, many times when we've gotten off track. When like, all right, this is what we're going to do. All right, let's go. Guns blazing, you know, and then like 3 months later, like, dude, weren't we supposed to be doing that over there? Like, why are we doing this now? All right, back to the business plan. Yep, refocus. So our business is constantly, we're constantly in a state of tweak, recalibrate, reevaluate. You know, you're steering the thing. All right, steer it back this way. Let's go try to get back in a straight line. And the goal with any business should try to be to get from point A to point B in as straight of a line as possible. You're going to have your ups and downs, but if that line could be as straight as possible, then you just did yourself a favor, right? You're going to save yourself a lot of heartache. You're going to reach your goals a lot faster. And because of that, your life's going to be a lot better.
Guys, and I also think this really gives a lot of clarity, right? When you leave today, you'll have some clarity on what you're going to want for 2023. And like Enrique says, you know, it's a roadmap to get there. But for me, it's huge to have that clarity. When we first started doing this VTO, Enrique and I, it gave a lot of clarity because you got to write stuff down. You got to see it on paper. And again, you get to reference it back. So leaving with the roadmap and then having clarity on what you need to put forward to go and accomplish these goals, right? You're going to have to put a lot of execution. It's not just doing this. It's actually now you have a plan, and then now you have to execute on that plan.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Execution is key, right? Great. So it's good that we set the intention, right? It's good that we understand why we're doing this, because I think if we understand why, then we'll take it a little bit more serious, right? And I remember in the beginning, sometimes it was like, oh, you're supposed to have a business plan because that's what you're supposed to do. That's what any good business owner does. And we didn't fully understand the value of it. And we were just kind of doing it just because that's what our coaches told us to do. That's what other agents did. But once we started actually doing a plan and started following it, and then you start seeing the wins happen, then you're like, oh shit, this works, right? And then once you're able to look back and you're able to check in on certain milestones throughout the year, and say, hey, this is the plan I started with. I followed it and look where I'm at. I'm on track, right? Or I'm off track. I got to recalibrate. I got to readjust. But it gives you that extra amount of clarity, right? And you become your own cheerleader, right? You become your own like advocate for like, hey, what you're doing is working. This is why you're doing it. Keep going. All right, good stuff. Let's dive into it, guys. So first page here, business planning worksheet. And one of the things, in order for us to fill this out correctly, I'm going to take you to another page. And this is just a quick little exercise we're going to do. Because we always want to start off with the end goal in mind, right? When it comes to business. Because just saying I want to close a lot of deals, or just saying like I want to close X amount of deals, and you don't really know what that means. Or just saying, hey, I want to make 100,000, but you don't know what that means in terms of how many deals, you know, how much volume, all those different things, then you're going into it blind. So to make your business plan effective, you need to know these numbers, right? And starting off with the end in mind is what all the great, you know, entrepreneurs do. They say, hey, this is where I want to be. And then they reverse engineer and work backwards, mm-hmm. right? And naturally, a lot of us say like, this is where I want to be. Let me just start here and start going forward. No, you actually got to do it the other way, right? You have to work backwards, because when you work backwards, then you could chunk it down into smaller things. You can say, okay, by mid-year, this is where I have to be, or by the first quarter, or by the month. And then that's a lot easier of a plan to follow, right? It's easier to say, hey, I got to close 2 deals a month because 2 deals a month will equal X amount of dollars versus saying, hey, I got to close 24 deals this year. It's a lot easier to focus on 2 deals a month and get down to like the monthly thing you got to do, and then break that down to a weekly thing than to try to look at this big goal and you think it's so far away. Because sometimes we get discouraged, right? When we set a goal, and if we're not on track because we're just looking at that big number, it's easy to get discouraged and say, hey, it's not working, right? So we got to kind of, you know, trick ourselves. We got to use a little bit of reverse psychology on ourselves and chunk it down to like the smallest of numbers, and then just focus on those things that we're going to do daily, weekly, and monthly. So income desired. So I want you guys just to write, if you have a note paper, even write somewhere on there. If you have a little section, or maybe at the bottom of one of the sections that's blank, you're just going to write these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 numbers, right? Number one is your income desired. How much income do you want to make at the end of the year? The end of 2023, and you look at your bank account and you see how much it's got deposited into your bank account. What is that number for you? Okay, so everyone got their number. Average price point. What is the average price point for the transactions that you typically work on, right? If you're newer, maybe you don't know what the average price point is. I mean, if you live in the South Bay, it's probably around $1 million, give or take. If you live in a different area, you know, then you might have to know your specific area. Or if you've already been in business and you kind of know your numbers, you know what you've been closing, then you can use your average price point and just put a number down there. And I'll do this example with you guys. So let's say $250,000 was my desired income. My average price point is $1 million. The next number is going to be, what is your average commission made on a deal, right? Like, what's the gross commission, GCI? Put GCI here. Before splits or anything like that. You're going to take whatever your average price point is and multiply it by 2.5% roughly. That's roughly what the average GCI is. So 2.5% times $1 million would be $25,000. That's the gross commission. Then the next thing we got to do is average take-home pay after splits, right? Whether you split it with your team, whether you split it with your broker, whatever your situation is, you need to plug in a split, right? What percentage of that 25,000 or whatever your number is, do you take home? It's going to vary for everybody, right? Because everyone's at different splits. If you're someone who's more of a top producer, I would maybe put like 70% on there, right? Or if you're higher up in the chain, right? If you're just starting and you're relying a lot on like team leads and stuff like that, and you're not really generating a lot of your own business, maybe just put 50% just to have like an even number. So I would say it's going to go from 50 to 70 or higher if you're at a higher split with your brokerage. And I like to use conservative numbers. I'd rather you use a lower number and just have something conservative than to go off like the best case scenario, right? Because best case scenarios don't always happen. So let's say 50% is what I take home after splits or expenses or whatever it might be. That'd be $12,500 in my example here. So multiply that by whatever your split is. And then the last one is basically you're going to just do what your total income was that you desired divided by how much you take home per deal, right? So in this case, 250,000 divided by 12,500 equals 20 transactions. Is anybody lost on how to come up with those numbers? We'll stay right here because I want to make sure everyone knows roughly what their number is. Doesn't have to be exact, guys, but you guys should have a ballpark of where you stand. This is extremely important, guys. Knowing this math, it's basic math. It's super basic, right? But you have to know how to come up with these numbers in your business. Because this right here is going to be the foundation of how you make calculations in your business, what to do, what not to do, who to call, who to focus on, right? How to chunk it down into monthly or quarterly. It's extremely crucial that you know how to quickly calculate, okay, what's my rough take home on a deal? How many deals would I have to do to be on track with my income?
You could see that again.
Yes. We'll start at the top again. Income desired, right? So just plug in, what is your desired income? Next step, what is the average price point of the homes that you typically sell or the homes in your market? If you're in our market, our area, you know, Silicon Valley, South Bay, I would use a million. A million is a good number. It's probably higher in some areas, but I think a million is just a good benchmark. If you're in outside areas, it's probably going to be a little bit lower. But I like to make these numbers really easy, right? Just super easy where it's not a whole, you know, calculus.
And equation. I think the good thing, guys, is that if you've been doing this business, you have a track record. And if you haven't, this is a good time to start tracking your numbers so that you can start identifying these.
Yep.
Right. And so, and if you're newer to the business, Enrique is using this example of 50%, right? So this is great for someone that's brand new, that's newer to the business, that's going to be leveraging more the team and the team leads. Someone that's more seasoned, you may have your own numbers that you can base it off.
Yeah, 50% is like a newer team agent. And then I would say like 70 to 80% is going to be more of an experienced agent.
And this is why it's extremely important that you track your business early on so that you guys can come up with these numbers.
Yeah, so you'll take your average price point, and then what you'll do is you'll multiply your average price point times 2.5%, which is roughly the average commission that is earned on a deal. And then that's going to give you your average GCI, gross commission income, $25,000. So if I sell $1 million house times 2.5%, $25,000 is generated, and then I'm going to get a percentage of that depending on my split with my team or my broker. Use 50% if you're a newer agent. Use 70 to 80% if you're more of an experienced agent who's already closing deals. Or if you have a different split and you know what your exact split is, then just plug that in as well. In this scenario now, what I'm doing is I'm taking my desired income. That's my goal, right? And I'm working backwards. I'm saying, okay, if I want to make $250,000 and I make roughly $12,500 per deal, I do $250,000 divided by $12,500. And that tells me I need to close 20 transactions at $1 million at 2.5% if I'm on a 50% split. Does that make sense, guys? Anybody still lost on that one? Okay, this is important, guys, because this is the number we're going to use to plug into our business planning worksheet. And the great thing about this, guys, is this is worst case scenario, right? Like if you put $1 million and you go close a $2 million deal, well, then it's less deals you got to close, right? Because sometimes that happens. Some of you guys are getting $3, $4 million deals. That's going to skew your numbers. It's just only going to make them better. But at least we want to go into it with the average worst case scenario and then be able to work our math from there. Any questions? Feel free to raise your hand at any time if you have any questions. Okay. Now let's get back to the worksheet. Now that you have your numbers, you can plug certain things in. Okay, so the first box, core values. What do core values mean? What does it mean to you guys? Raise your hand, anybody who wants to say what core values mean to them. What's the definition of core value? Anybody?
No, but I almost want to say it's like the things you live by. They don't change. Put ourselves out
there. Yep. Your truths, the things you live by, the way you run your business. Like, hey, if I had to define my business in, you know, 3 bullet points or 5 or 6, like it's these certain things that are characteristics of me and how I operate in my business. Right? So how do you operate in your business? Us on our team, we have core values as a team. We hustle and work hard. You know, we have a growth mindset, positive attitude. We're team players. We embrace accountability. Those are our core values as a team. But I want you guys to develop core values on your own, right? Because you may have another thing that you want to put in there. That's something that you live by that's important to you. So it's how you approach your business and the things that you stand by. It doesn't have to be six. It could be three. You can keep it simple. It could be four, five, or six. I would do no more than six. I would say 3 to 6 is kind of a good thing. And these are things that, hey, if I want to go back and keep referencing how I show up to my business or the attitude that I have or the way I present myself in my business or how I, you know, conduct my business, these are the things that would summarize that. So let's take some time right now, just listing anywhere from 3 to 6 core values that you want to stand by. And these are going to be more about you guys. These aren't going to be about your clients. So that's, you know, that would be more like a mission statement or something like that. These are more about you. Like, what's your approach to business, right? How do you conduct yourself? What are your personal truths? And I just Googled it. This is a good definition. Core values are traits or qualities that are not just worthwhile. They represent an individual or an organization's highest priorities, deeply held beliefs, and core fundamental driving forces. They are the heart of what you or your organization and its employees stand for in their business, basically. Really quick, if it's easier, guys, we can brainstorm real quick, right? Because some of you guys may be stuck on coming up with them. So why don't we spend the next 5 minutes and feel free to discuss with the people in front of you and brainstorm maybe some ideas and see which ones kind of resonate for you.
You can also post our
commercial. Yeah.
We can share with you guys our core values.
Well, five. Am I missing one? Positive attitude.
I have to. You
want me to check too? You want me to check? I have to. No,
Thank you.
Tyler, you made me feel old.
What do you say?
Guys, is anybody still writing them down? We're going to move on to the next section. Raise your hand if you're still writing yours down. You guys all got them down? All right, we're good. All right, guys, the next area right here is going to be your core focus, your purpose, your cause, your passion. And maybe like your niche, right? So core focus, this is frequently referred to as a mission, a vision, or a voice. It's all about defining why the company exists and identifying your superior skill. Once defined, the combination of these two things help you stay focused, and it's easy to get distracted by non-core activities. So why do you exist in this business? Like, what's your mission? And this might be how you serve clients now, right? What's your mission to the client? This would be more of like your mission statement, purpose, cause, or passion, or some sort of niche that you bring to the market. What do you bring to the market? What are you hoping to do for your clients? What's your purpose? What drives you to show up every day and make it happen for your clients?
Deep work.
The deeper you can go on this, guys, the better, right? Like, give it some meaning, you know, like, why real estate, right? Like, yeah, we're going to talk about money and making money, but this is not the money part. Or it could be like, what you're going to do with the money. Maybe you want to give back to people. Maybe you never owned a home. Your family never owned a home in your life and you want to change that. Or you want to be, you know, help someone accomplish their dream. There's a lot of things that you can do, right? A lot of things that can be the mission or the voice or the reason why you put yourself in this really tough job, right? It's a competitive job that we're in, a career, but why? And guys, the reason this is important is, as you guys are working on this, if you don't have something bigger than you, right, or bigger than just making money or closing deals, you're going to lose motivation, right? If all you're here for is to make a buck, right, that's, you can go make a buck anywhere, right? There's easier ways, you know, to make a buck if you just need a buck, right? This is a challenging job, right? So it's going to require you to put yourself out there, to get uncomfortable, to do things, to really push yourself, you know? So there has to be something that you look towards that's like the bigger reason, the bigger meaning, your why, what your mission is all about. Because those are the things that will help push you during those times that you feel unmotivated. The times that your clients, you know, ghost you, or a deal falls apart. If you have something to go back to, well, let me go back to why I'm doing this, why I'm doing this, why I'm doing this. That helps push you through those tough times. And that might change. That might change throughout your career as well, right? So this is not an end all be all. This business plan is going to be an evolving one, but you should start somewhere. Raise your hand. Anybody still working on this part? If you're still working on this part, raise your hand really quick. Okay, we'll give it another minute. Okay, guys, let's move on to 10-year target. This is now thinking 10 years down the line, right? This is like future. I know some of us don't think that far. Some of us are thinking about right now, which is great, but it's important to sometimes think 10 years down the road so that you have something to work towards. So what's your 10-year target? Like if you had to look 10 years from now, it's about to be 2023. Think about that, 2033. Yeah, does that even sound real? That sounds weird, right, to say that? 2033, right? In 2033,
10 years.
This is the big, big goal, right? And this may change, guys, right? But it's good to put something out there, right?
Yeah.
Let's throw something out into the world. Let's manifest something. Let's set an intention out there of something that we're working towards. So I want you to write one statement. It could be one, like, you know, good sentence of like, all right, this is how it looks, right? Or this is how my life looks, or this is how the business looks. And then write down some numbers in terms of, you know, how much real estate are you selling? You know, how many units, how much volume, and how much, you know, income are you bringing in 10 years from now? So put a statement, what does it look like? Or what, you know, if you had to define it in one, you know, nice sentence, like, all right, 10 years from now, like, this is where I need to be, right? Boom, it's gonna look like this. And then this is the kind of production I'm doing. It could be your personal production. You could say, hey, in 10 years, I want a team like the size of all these people here, and I want to be selling 1,000 homes a year, right? I know that's one of our big goals, is to get to 1,000 units a year. Mm-hmm. You don't get to 1,000 units by just, you know, one day saying I'm going to do 1,000. You get to it by throwing it out there and then start working backwards, right? All right, we got to get to this number first, then we got to get to this number, then we got to get to that number. $1 billion a year of real estate. That's our goal. Our team's doing $1 billion a year. Probably by the time we reach that, $1 billion isn't going to be that big of a deal, right? But it is for me, right? Because think about it, guys. More and more people are starting to hit like bigger and bigger numbers, right? Like it becomes doable. Freaking lotto is $1.9 billion. No one hit it, right?
Someone did.
Which that means that's why you got to keep focusing on this plan right here, right? Because you guys are still here today, right? Today wasn't your day to hit the lotto.
I think, guys, it's important to understand we're going 10 years, then we go 3 years and 1 year, right? So again, just remember we are going to go backwards. So make sure you make that number big, or how you want it in the next 10 years. Put it out.
Yeah.
The lotto's gone.
The lotto's gone, guys. Sorry. Guys. Isn't it funny how everyone starts thinking what they would do if they won the lotto? You start plotting it out. Oh, I won the lotto. Oh, you start talking about it. Like, I know I was. I don't know. And then I woke up and I was like, oh, I got to get to work today. I made it back to this business planning workshop. $1 billion. All right. We're going to go off to marketing strategy. And this one I'll let you guys brainstorm on. Feel free to talk with the people next to you. But the top part, your target market or ideal client, right? I want you guys to be intentional. Like, who's my ideal client? Am I working with buyers? Am I working with sellers? Am I working with both? Am I working with first-time buyers? Am I working with tech and, you know, people in tech? Start putting some ideas down. Like, who's your ideal client that you want to work with? The reason this is important is because when you know what your ideal client is, then it becomes clear on like who you need to say yes to and who you need to say no to. Because if you start saying yes to people who aren't your ideal client or aren't in alignment with the price points you need to sell, the goals, everything you mapped out, remember, you start getting derailed from your goal, right? Raise your hand if you got derailed a couple of times because you live in San Jose and you wanted to take a listing in Fresno or something, right? Happens all the time,
yep.
Right? Yeah, but it's a listing. Well, got to go back to the business plan, right? Is that in alignment with where you're trying to be in the next year, 3 years, 10 years, right?
Or you just refer it out.
Yeah. Or should you just refer it out and then and go back and focus on the clients that you're trying to go after? There's nothing wrong with Fresno, right? But if you live in Fresno, great, service that client. But if you live in San Jose and you're just trying to get any deal you can, it starts taking you away from what your ultimate goal is. And that happens, guys. And this is where being intentional comes into play. What are your three uniques? So what will you specialize in, right? So who's your ideal type of client? And then what are the three unique things that you bring to the table? Maybe you're a first-time buyer specialist. Maybe you're great with elderly people. Maybe, you know, you're a listing specialist. Maybe you have a certain niche market, right? Maybe you're Spanish speaking or you speak a different language, or maybe you commercial properties, whatever it might be. You know, what are maybe three uniques or three areas that you want to focus on? Or maybe three things you're really good at. It could be, hey, I have a background in construction, right? So I work really well with investors who want to flip properties or developers and stuff like that. And then the next section is going to be, what are your top three lead sources? Where is your business going to come from? One of them should be your SOI, your sphere of influence, your family, your friends. That should be one of them, right? Working your past clients, the people who know, like you, and trust you. That definitely should be one of them. That should probably be number one in everyone's business. And then number two and three is like, what are the other things that you're going to do to generate business? Are you working online leads? You know, on our team, we do a lot of online lead generation. Are you open house, like the king of open houses? Are you the networker, right? You go to every networking event and that's how you get deals.
Bless you.
Door knocking.
Are you the door knocker, right? You love door knocking and that's like going to be a staple in your business. Are you the social media person, right? Like all my business, I'm going to go deep with social media. So this is where you got to get really specific on where your lead sources are at. That doesn't mean that you're not going to take business that comes from something else, but it should be like, this is what I'm going to focus on, right? Because what I have learned, you know, from personal experience is when you try to focus on too many things, you don't do any of them at a high level. The best operators that I know in business, the guys that run like really high level businesses, they don't add any other lead source until they've mastered the one that's in front of them. And that's a problem for a lot of us in the business is we get distracted and we chase the shiny objects and the squirrels and this one sounds good. Or this other guy said, do Facebook ads. Well, I thought you were the door knocker. When's the last time you door knocked? Yeah, you're right, huh? But now you're doing Facebook ads. You see, like, that can quickly derail you from the plan because there's many ways to do the business. So this is where I want you to be intentional about what are your top three lead sources. If you only could pick three and that was it, you couldn't do anything else in your business and you had to go deep with these three and go all in and do them at the highest level possible, what would be the three ways that you would generate business? And I would also take into consideration, what are the ones that you love doing as well? Because even though, you know, you can make a lot of money door knocking, it works. But if you don't love door knocking and being out there every day, you're going to be fighting that thing all the time, right? If you don't love working open houses, you're going to be fighting it all the time. If you don't love doing social media and you put social media on there, you're going to be fighting that all the time. But here's the truth. You have to pick something, right? Like if you're in this business and you're going to work and you want to make money and you want to build a business, you have to pick something, right? Picking nothing is not an option. All right, really quick, let's share. Pick the person next to you. Share with them your marketing strategy. Target market, ideal client, your three uniques, and your top three lead sources. Let's spend 2 minutes on that. DJ. I will try to get like some further shots, like Connie and what's her name? Just to mix it up, something like in a little bit of and maybe just like a couple pants. 1 minute reel.
And
All right, let's go, guys. Let's wrap it up. We're going to go on to the next one. All right, really quick. I need someone to share some stuff. I'm just going to throw it out there. Raise your hand and share. What's your target market or ideal client? Who can share what they wrote down? Target market or ideal client? Someone raise their hand, just share what they wrote down in theirs. Juan.
Well, I grew up in East Palo Alto, so I know the surrounding areas. So my ideal target market is going to be the peninsula.
The peninsula? Okay. Any specific type of client?
Honestly, any buyers, any kind of buyers.
Buyers for now? Okay. Anybody else? Target client, target market or ideal client? Okay. So people starting families, people who are in tech, those type of clients. That's your ideal client. Awesome. Three uniques. What will you specialize in? What are you good at? Who would like to share? Just give me your three uniques really quick.
I have a designation in seniors, working with seniors.
Working with seniors? Yeah. Awesome. Sorry, yes. Awesome. What else did you write down?
And then I have a designation in RCSD, which is divorce. So people that are going to be going through a divorce.
Okay.
They have a home. Actually working more with with them as well, but also to get a lead from a lawyer. So a divorce lawyer is what I'm focusing on, the legal association.
Nice. So working with seniors.
So
there you go. That's good. And that brings value, right? You have the designation, you have experience, right? You have, you know, contacts, lawyers and stuff like that. That's good. Okay. Top three lead sources. What'd you guys write down? Someone share. What are your top three lead sources that you're going to focus on? Lead sources or pillars, Brenda?
I have SOIs, family and friends, open houses, and team leads.
SOI. Open houses and team leads. Awesome. Yeah. Dewey.
SOI, client, and then also putting out video.
Social media. Mm-hmm. Social media, your past clients, and close friends and family. Awesome. Who else? Top three lead sources. Where's your business coming from? Anybody else that wrote something different that stands out?
Lisa. I added to it video marketing referrals and
video marketing referrals and like team leads. Okay, awesome. Anybody write down anything else besides those? Like,
I want to focus more on sellers. So really going to focus more on for sale by owners and expireds.
Okay.
Along with circle prospecting.
Okay. For sale by owners, expired, circle prospecting. Good stuff. Anybody doing like networking? Anything like that? Was that one that anybody wrote down?
I did networking.
Networking?
Yes, open houses.
Yeah. Anna wrote down networking.
Oh,
seriously. All right. Enrique. There you go. All right. Networking, right? Networking's a great one. So here's the thing, guys, when you guys write this stuff down, remember, this isn't about really like the how are you going to do it. The how is going to come later, right? Like, okay, if you're going to do networking, then you're going to want to spend some time figuring out, okay, if I'm doing networking, I got to map that out for the year, right? Am I attending an event, you know, twice a month, or am I hosting my own events, or what am I doing? That's going to come later, right? When you're breaking down the how, because the how is the easy part, honestly, right? Like everything's been done. If you just Google it, YouTube it, all that stuff, it's been done, right? It's coming up with the what are my things? What are the things that resonate with me? What do I love? What, you know, what gets me out of bed? What's something that I can commit to? That's the hard part, right? Once you figure that out, then the how is just, you know, you go look that up, right? Or you brainstorm with someone else. So I encourage you all to use this as the starting point. And then later on, you're going to want to map out, okay, how are you going to make these things happen? Okay. Any questions, guys, on the marketing strategy part? All right, let's go 3-year picture. We went 10-year, now we're gonna go 3-year, right? So if you wanna just divide that by 3, you can do that. But the 3-year picture, right? So here you're gonna paint a picture of what the company or your business will look like 3 years from now. This helps you see, right? Or everybody within the company, if you're doing it company-wide, where they'll be at, how they'll be a part of it. And it's divided into 2 parts, right? So the top part is like the specifics, the measurables. Right. Okay. X amount of deals, units, volume, whatever it might be. And then the other part is going to be what it looks like. Right. So in 3 years, what would I like my business to look like? You can write down like certain things that are going on in your business. Maybe there's certain awards you've done. Maybe there's certain accomplishments you've had. You know, maybe there's, you know, you have a team, there's a certain amount of people on your team. Maybe there's a certain marketing pillar that you're doing. Right. So if you had to just write down maybe, you know, up to 8 bullet points of what it would look like, jot them down there. So pick a date, three years from now, write down the measurables, how many units, volume, and GCI. If you wanna just take your 10-year and divide it by 3, you can do that. And then more importantly is what's it gonna look like at that time?
For that year.
Yeah, at the end of that 3 years, okay, what's my business looking like in 3 years? Like I know for us, because we do this on a company level, right? It could be like, hey, we have 100 agents on our team, you know, in that year, right? Or, hey, we're doing networking events, you know, twice a month, right? Or, you know, we have 10 offices or whatever it might be. It's like now getting specific about certain things. We've sold this many homes, or we won an award for this, right? Or we've took over a certain market. Right. So those are certain things you can jot down.
And just to give you guys some reference, I mean, some of our 3 years, when we look back 3 years ago, was to, you know, get out of production and give completely back to the team. Right. Those are certain goals. That's how we saw our 3 years, was to pull ourselves out of production so we can focus highly with our agents.
Yep. And if it's funny, because we did this and we go back and look at it, there's a lot of things that we accomplished on that. Right. And there's some that's like, hey, we didn't get there yet, and we got to keep pushing it over to the next year.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. You can smell the tacos now? We got to run to the second page. We got to go quick to the second page, guys.
I said tacos. I didn't eat yesterday.
It's three per person. Three per person.
Don't worry.
Don't worry. For you, all right.
Yeah. Yeah, I think I do that. I'll come right back.
I want to give it two more minutes. Two more minutes. We're going to muscle through the back page. We're going to muscle through it. Back pages will be a little easier. A lot of the calculations were already done. Hey, that could be it. You can write 3 years. I am a doctor.
Something doctor? Else. Do I look?
Holistic. I mean,
this is what I really like about it. It makes you really think.
Yeah.
This really makes you really, if you want to take this serious, it really makes you think, where am I going to be at?
Yeah.
I think it's cool. I have
We don't take enough time to do this.
That could be it, though. That could be part of it. Like, hey, I'm also doing this. You know? There you go. I'm selling. I'm on Ryan Serhant's team. Yeah. I'm running PRG New York.
Okay. I will go to
the company. What's up? Let's go.
I mean, so did I.
With the license.
He wants to move out there. He's going to get a job out there. And
all right, 30 more seconds, guys, and then we're going to move on. Want to get you guys some tacos. You just realized it. I know some people only came for the tacos, bro. There's just going to be some people that. All right, guys, let's wrap this part up. We're going to go to page 2. You can feel free to come back to this if you got to think about it a little bit more. Let's flip over to page 2, the backside. All right. We're going to try to muscle through page 2 because I want to get you guys fed. I know some people are starting getting hangry pretty soon. So we got about 20 more minutes to work through page 2. The great thing is we did a lot of the work, so a lot of this is just fill in the blanks. So here's what I want you guys to do. On the one-year plan, I want you to take whatever your three-year goal was and just divide it by 3. See how you feel about that number. This is basically what's the measurable for the next year. By the end of 2023, what's the units, volume, GCI? You can write GCI or income, right? Your income that you make 2023. So yeah, an easy way is to take your 3 year and divide it by 3.
The volume?
Yeah, the measurable. So you're going to write future date, right? So on number 1 right here, let me edit this real quick so you guys can see how I do it. Yeah, same thing you did earlier. So future date, I'm going to put, 12/31/2023, right? End of 2023, my measurable. So how many units did I sell? How much volume did I do? And then how much GCI or how much income did I bring home? You can take whatever your three-year number was and divide it by 3. But then what's going to happen is there's going to be 2 things that happen. Is you're like, whoa, that sounds very low. And that tells you that maybe you weren't shooting your sights high enough, right? If your one-year number sounds really low and you're like, nah, that doesn't sound right. and you might have to do a readjustment. Or if you set your 3-year really high and then you divide that by 3 and you're like, oh, that's way too high. Like, I don't know if that's something I can do. So this is where you might have to do a little bit of an edit, right? To get what your 1-year number is going to be. And remember, growth is not always linear, right? Like, I'm just doing an easy way to just divide it by 3, but growth is not always linear, right? You can have a year where you're building systems, processes, and then the next year, boom, you just take off and you double or triple. That happens also. But easy way is just divide the numbers up.
We can also reference the first exercise you
did. Yeah. Right? You could reference that first exercise, right, that we did where you take your income desired and stuff like that, if that's your goal. And you can write that number in there as well.
And we can give an example, Enrique, like if we use the 250 income.
Yeah, so if I say, remember I did that exercise in the beginning where I wrote down this example of the income desired and all that. So what I can do is I can plug that in now. So 20 units, my volume, 20 units times a million, so it'd be 20 million. And then my GCI, you know, is going to be 250,000.
No.
The GCI would be more. It'd be 20 times 2.5. It would be, what's that, 500,000?
Yeah.
500K GCI. And then I can write next to it, my take-home income would be 250K take-home.
This is based on the first exercise we did.
Yeah. So write your GCI and then also write your income next to it, like what your take-home income is. And then once you're done with that, guys, then you're going to go to the quarterly section. And all you're going to do is just divide that by 4 quarters. Right? So 20. I'm going to have you fill in these two first. So if I'm doing 20 deals next year, that's my goal. Divide that by 4 quarters. That means 5 units per quarter. 5 million in volume.
Just to give clarification, guys, because quarterly rocks mean each quarter of the year. Right, so that's what that's going into.
Yeah, we're chunking it down to a quarter.
Down to every few months. Every 3 months, this is what you're expecting to get, or what your goal is.
Yeah.
So what do you divide by 3 volume?
So whatever you put for your three-year goal on the front side of the sheet, you can either divide that by 3 to come up with your 1 year, right? If you're going 3 year and then you're dividing it by 3 to come up with the 1 year, or the exercise we did in the beginning where we wrote down like our desired income, you can just plug that number in as well. I'd probably encourage you to more plug in your desired income number, right? That you did in the beginning, that everyone did that calculation. Plug that number in there. Sorry if I'm confusing you guys. Let me start one more time. Whatever number you came up with in the beginning, your desired income, right? And then we worked backwards. Plug that number in for your 1 year plan, right? That's the measurable. By the end of the year, that's what I wanted to hit. 20 units. That's, you know, for my example, 20 million, 500,000 was the GCI, and then divided, my take home would be 250 based on my split.
This is important, guys, that you guys know these numbers. So if you guys need help, raise your hand and maybe someone next to you can help you. If not, I can come over.
Yeah, feel free to ask the person next to you, guys, if you guys need help.
Go ahead and take a few minutes.
And then what you'll do, guys, on the quarterly part, you're just going to divide that into 4 quarters, right? So you take that 1 year number, you divide it by 4, and that breaks it down every quarter. Every quarter is 3 months and a quarter.
Yeah. Talk to you. Okay. Yeah, we're not going that far. We're just going to end the end zone. Yeah. Yeah.
I'm
No, you're fine. It's fine. I got you. So let's go.
Sorry. Yeah.
And that was like first started off with. That was it.
Right, that's the easiest way to look at it. And then what we're going to do with your price is the volume is going to be 23 million. Right?
And then what we're going to do is we're going to be playing with the team. And we're going to become 10 to 2 and a half percent, correct? And 6.5 and 10 is going to be the growth of the GCI. Right? And then the GCI is going to be the total commission collection, right? And whatever you're supposed to do. Enrique is exactly, he's doing a 50% split. Multiplied by times 70, it's 402.
And I'm a baby.
No. But yeah, you don't know if you have your referral pay. And then here, what's going to happen is, so this is for the year. So then now you're going to have to divide all these numbers by four. Yes.
Anybody need help coming up with their quarter number, their 1 year number? Guys, real quick, I'm gonna break it down up here one more time so you guys can see how I came up with the number. Yeah, if you remember my exercise in the beginning, you know, I came up with my desired income. And then I figured out after splits, $250,000 was my income, $12,500 per deal. That means I need to do 20 deals in a year, right? That was my one year goal. So I'll plug that one in, the 1 year goal. And then for quarter, if I want to divide that up into quarters, then I'll just divide it by four, right? So then I'd have $250,000 divided by four. $62,500 is per quarter. And then by 20 deals divided by four, that's going to be basically five deals, right? So that's my quarter number. $62,500 is going to be the income. Five deals times 1 million. So it's going to be 5 million in volume. And you see here what I wrote. 20 deals here, 20 million, 250K, and then I just divided it by four. Five units, 5 million, 62,500.
The volume is going to be 5 million. Right? Because each unit is a million. Right? The volume is going to be 5 million. Right? So then we'll do it. It's 5 million.
Huh?
It's not quick, right?
Say something quick, man. You gotta put me on the spot. Start spinning the flow, bro. It's the work, man. It's the work that it takes to build a big business, a profitable business. Hold on, one more time. This is the work that it takes to build a big business, a profitable business, and a business that is predictable, that you can continue to scale over and over and over. You got to break it down. You got to break the numbers down. And you got to have a plan that you follow. Otherwise, you can get derailed really easily. Tip of the day. All right, raise your hand if you're still calculating your number, your 1 year and your quarterly number. Is anybody still calculating that? You wrote everything down?
Yeah.
Oh, you're good. All right.
I'm going to go get a line.
No, because then everyone's going to start doing that. Hey, hit the bell. All right, guys, let's go. We're almost done. All right. So in order to hit your 1 year goal, right? What must happen that year to hit my 1 year goal? I want you to write down five bullet points of what must happen. On the first column, 1 year plan. For your 1 year plan.
The first thing you did before was just the numbers.
Yeah. So now we're in the first column here. 1 year plan. What must happen? Right? What must happen in order to hit that number? What are things you can immediately think of either that you got to focus on, that you got to work on, maybe changes you need to make. Some goals, right? Some goals for the year. Or specific targets, things that need to happen in that year to be on track to hit your one-year plan. It could be like, hey, I gotta get more consistent on my marketing. It could be like, I have to master my buyer presentation or my listing presentation, or I have to start taking my business more seriously, right?
Or I gotta show up at a certain
time. Or I need to fix something that's going on at home, you know, that's stopping me from showing up to the office, or I gotta make some changes in my lifestyle, right? There's certain things where if you break it down, you need to make these changes or you need to implement certain things. It's gonna look different for everybody. Let me see, hold on, let me make it a little, All right. Guys, if I can have your attention. So this is where we start losing people a lot of times, right? We have this one-year goal, and we start losing people because it seems so far away. So this is your time to now break it down into a quarter strategically, right? We know what we got to make happen in the whole year, but what are the most important things that need to happen in the next 3 months, right? In the first 3 months of my business to be on track, right? Because you're measurable. This is your checkpoint, right? Your first quarter is your checkpoint to see if you're on track for the whole year. If you want to close 20 deals in the year, that means you would need to close at least 5 by the first quarter, right? So what are the key things I must focus on in the next 3 months that are the most important things that are going to allow me to get on track, right? Because we can have that whole year thing. That may be a long list. That's looking down a year, right? But we want to get really intentional about what needs to happen now. So make sure you fill in those quarterly rocks.
And again, really quick, guys, it's important that you guys chunk this out to quarterly, because what happens is you get overwhelmed if you try to do everything at once. So it's important that you pick a few of these rocks and work on them during that quarter, right? So again, this is going to be the whole list. And then over here is going to be what you're going to be working on during those quarters.
And you don't need to have 5 either, right? You can have 2. You can have 3. I would say at least 2 to 3. You know, some, because maybe 5 is too much, right? It's only, especially if you're just one person, if you have help, you know, from a team or an assistant or something like that, then maybe you can divvy those up as well. I know with us, when we do our rocks, we'll map out like 5 or 6 rocks in a quarter. There'll be certain ones that I'm working on, certain ones that Jason is, and there'll be certain ones that our admin team are working on. And then collectively, we'll get 5 things done in our business in one quarter. When it was just us, then we were doing like 2 or 3. Right? What were the most important ones?
And going really deep into those ones. So yeah. You master it, right? You don't move on to the next one until you master them.
Yeah. And that's the hard part, right? Is sometimes we'll pick things and then we start working on it and we see, oh, all right, it's working, but we haven't really gone deep on it. And then we start trying to take on something else. And then that one kind of goes to the wayside, right? So you want to get really, really, really just specific on what are the top 3. I would even say top 3 if you're just a single person. Top 3 things you got to work on in this next quarter. And that becomes your sole focus. That's the only thing you're looking at. And you already know, I got my blinders on, like you said earlier, Roscoe, right? Yeah, that sounds like a good idea, but nope. These are my 3 right here. I ain't looking at Jack, right? I'm only looking at these 3. I'm checking in on these 3. And then after 3 months, I'm going to see where I'm at, see if I knocked them out. If I didn't knock them out, then I can roll them over to the next quarter. And that happens sometimes with us, is we might pick 2 or 3 things. And maybe we did 2 of them and then 1 of them just kind of, you know, wasn't the priority, or we did it halfway. It's like, no, we got to roll this one over. Or we got something in place and we don't feel like it's just deep enough. All right, we got to just keep doing it again. And just think about that. If you ran your business in quarters and you did 2 or 3 things that you implement in your business every quarter, multiply that by 4, that's 8 to 12 things that you added to your business. It could be a system. It could be a process. It could be a habit. It could be, you know, a lead source. That's how you move a business forward consistently. It isn't doing 1,000 things at one time. It's doing a few things and just going really deep and then compounding on a quarterly basis. Make sense, guys? And then the last part, guys, is the issues list. Remember, we talked about this morning, things are going to happen, right? When we first started the meeting, we said we'd be foolish to not think that something is going to come up. There's already things coming up, right? We have the market shifting. There's stuff like that that's happening. These are external factors that can get in the way. Maybe we have personal things that we're dealing with that can get in the way, right? So it's like, what are some potential issues or obstacles that may prevent you from reaching your goal? Because if we can already anticipate some of these things and we can get ahead of them, we can start putting things in place, right? To get ahead of them, or just more self-awareness or adjustments that we need to make. And this gives you clarity. Like right now, the issue that we have right now, this current moment, we got the market, we got the holidays. Those are two issues right now that can get in the way of our business, right? Two issues right now that can be an obstacle or a distraction, right? We're facing those things. So if we already know those things, then we got to figure out a game plan of how we're going to maneuver around those so that we can stay on track with our goal. Let's go over, let's do a little bit of sharing, guys. We're coming to the end of this. Goals for the year. What are some of the things that you wrote down that must happen for you to hit your goals for the year? Who would like to volunteer and just share some ideas? Miles. Getting out of your comfort zone. What else? Give me three of them. Three things you wrote down.
Networking.
You need to network more.
And
follow up. You do more follow up, get out of your comfort zone, and commit to more networking. Solid, solid. Anybody else? Some things that must happen in the next year to stay on track with your goal. How about in the quarter? How about like immediately, right? Like, what are some things that need to happen like very, very soon in the next quarter or in the first quarter of the year that I need to really put in place? Social media. Mm-hmm. More presence on social media.
They say, don't be a secret agent.
Don't be a secret agent.
I'm a secret agent.
Raise your hand if you feel like you're a secret agent, like you don't really put yourself out there. Lily, you raised your hand? Yeah, what are you talking about? Okay. Okay, so Lily, you're barely tapping into it. You've come a long way. I've seen your progress. What advice can you give her about how to get started with social media?
You just have to do it. Like, honestly, like what I do is like.
Hold on, guys.
Hey, real quick.
I will just post it, and I literally I don't think about it. I just let it go, and then after, then I'm like, oh, I don't like the way my hair looks. I don't like the way I said this word, or I don't like the tone of that, or I don't like the lighting. I just want to post it. I like
it. Are you videos when you're doing videos?
Yeah, I do a lot of like, I just kind of find doing like a lot of the reels.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So.
What was the first thing you guys did to kickstart it?
Oh, so, and they get challenged us, everyone, like, what was it, like a few months ago, to do like a 30-day, like, video challenge, like every single day for 30 days, you need to post something like real estate related. But the one challenge is like you have to be on camera. It couldn't be like a tour. It couldn't be like talking. It needed to be like your face. And I think people had really good intentions. I think like most of the team started. because it was really challenging. Because sometimes you can't think of what to post. You're like, what do I do today? And then at the end of the day, it was just myself, Connie, and Jessica that did it. And that's kind of what made me want to do it. And then once I got like the fear of it, then I'm like, okay, well now, before the challenge was just being consistent and like the quality wasn't going to be the best because I just needed to roll them out. And now we're doing another challenge where it's more focused on like the intention of what you're posting. So now it's like 2 times per week. And it helps to have like a motivation because like, he's taking a Napa, I love to drink. So and I said to myself, like, I set goals for myself. And if I, once I like, you know, like meet them, then I like treat myself to something. Like I'll treat, like right now, like I have a certain goal. And then if I reach it, then I'm going to treat myself like on a vacation. Or, so that's what helps me.
Yeah.
Like look forward to
so they were the last three that that finished, and then the prize was took them to Alexander's for lunch, right? So we had a nice lunch at Alexander's. Of course, they grubbed, and then now the prize is like a day trip to Napa. Whoever finishes the video challenge, right?
24 videos.
24 videos in the last quarter.
Like I don't know what to post now, and like it's easier when you have somebody who has the same goal. Like one of my things that I put on like what I want to do in the quarter, I put like to team up with another person that has like the same goals as I do, because I think it's just easier when you have
someone. So like an accountability like, partner or someone that can push you. Yeah.
Just do it. So yeah, that's my goal. Just do it. Do it and forget about it.
Good stuff. Thanks for sharing. That's good. Really good. Who else, guys? Rocks for the quarter. What's something that you must immediately start to work on? You raise your hand? Oh, I guess you're stretching. Lisa.
Yeah, I think it's really asserting myself in my home and family life. Like, oh, sometimes I get taken that seriously to being in real estate. And I really got to put my foot down, like, no, I have to walk this amount of time here. I need to talk to the kids, or I need to leave the kitchen and go to spend 2 hours in the room. You know, it's really just making everyone aware that this is serious.
Yeah. Anybody have some advice on how, because this is a new career, right? Yeah. And you're a mom and you have some kids, right? And there's that whole balancing out. Anybody have some advice on how she can be taken more serious?
Why are you doing it? Why? You don't have to. Well, because I want to, right? Just letting them know why I'm doing it. And once they see my dad, like, damn, no passion. All right, he just backed off completely. But it's a time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Time blocking.
Yeah, I think another thing is to, you know, you have this written down. I think it's good to share this with your support system, right? With your partner. Show them what your goals are, why you're working hard, why you're working the weekends, why you need this time. And you got to get there. You also have to get their buy-in. Right, because you're gonna need their support, especially if you have a family, to have success in both with your family and with your business.
Yeah, and what I want to add to that is what he's giving you an example of by you showing them that is no one's gonna take you serious until you take yourself serious, right? If you don't take yourself serious and show them like with action that this is what I'm doing, eventually people get the hint, right? But if you're inconsistent, then they're not really going to take you that serious. And especially if you're new to the business and you're trying to tap into your friends and family, it's going to take some time for them to say, oh, okay, you're in real estate now. And the quickest way to let them know you're in real estate is to show them with action and show them that you're consistent and show them that you've taken yourself serious. And then over time, their perception will change. Right now, your family just knows you as the mom, right? That's what they know you as, because you're in a transition right now of establishing yourself as the working mom, the real estate mom, right? And stuff like that. So that's going to take some time. So just stick with it. And like the more serious you can be and show them with action, like he said, showing them that business plan, showing them what you're up to, communicating that over time, that will change for you.
I think what Jason said was really good. I took off to Michigan a couple of weeks after, and it was a coaching seminar, Jason knows, and I took my girl. So she doesn't, she's home. But I was able to take her over there, and she was able to get surrounded with all these people and get with minded people and see their success stories. So getting your partner involved with the process, getting them involved with the systems that you've got going on, cheerlead them on. So a prime example, by taking my girl out, she ended up winning me a coaching, and she was excited. She was getting the praise of the whole bit. But it, I mean, it worked out for me. It benefited me as well, right? But it also, it was, we're a team now, right? She was happy. She said, hey, listen, are you happy? She was using words like that, right? But it got her involved in the whole thing, yeah. Right? So it's get the purse, get yourself involved.
Yeah.
I was just going to say, so like when I didn't have my spouse on board, if you marry your dad, they're just so similar. You know? I just found someone else, my neighbor. My neighbor, I'm trying to make it. I'm trying to prove them wrong. I need you to help me out. And so if I call her, she watches my kids no matter what. She went with me to the sales mastery. I got her room. She watched my kids. So she went to the room, saw the people, was around the energy. So I have her. And that was my first Monday call.
Nice.
There you go. Good stuff, guys. All right, real quick, issues list. What are some of the obstacles you guys wrote down for your issues list? Who would like to share? What are some obstacles that could potentially get in your way? Anna?
Myself, my fears, my anxiety, just mental health in general, but I think having the community around me really helps me and pushes me to become better. But, you know, there's always that in the back of my mind where I know it's a possibility again, or it's part of the journey, right? Part of life. So it'll happen eventually, but I think just knowing how I was able to move past it this time in order to, you know, if it happens again, now I know, like, hey, I can get back to it, which is why I'm here, like, this week, where I'm like, no, it's nice to see you guys here too.
Awesome. So. Yeah, and that's great self-awareness, right? Like, just knowing, hey, like, this is a challenge that I have, right? This is something that I deal with. And then being able to put the stuff into action, right? So. Awesome. Who else has an issue that they wrote down? Obstacle or issue that may prevent you from reaching your goals?
I said procrastination.
Procrastination. Raise your hand if you feel like you procrastinate. I know I do for sure. All right. Yeah, I'll raise my hand tomorrow, right? Simple and true. Now, guys, what do you think you need to do to combat the procrastination?
Well, I need to follow my calendar. If it's not on the calendar, it doesn't exist.
Yep.
So we need to follow a schedule.
Follow a schedule.
I don't think there's a better way of eliminating procrastination than like following
a schedule. Anybody else have something that they can?
Maybe a pointer? An accountability partner.
That's what I was thinking.
Yeah. An accountability partner, someone that you can, you know, they can hold you accountable, and it doesn't have to be even someone in the business. It can be someone outside of the business, right?
Yeah. Sometimes it's hard to find an accountability partner, right? Because people are busy and you may not have someone you feel comfortable with. Mm-hmm. I know for me, to hold myself personally accountable, every time I would work out, I would post it on social media, right? And some people may think like, oh yeah, you're just trying to show you're working out. No, like that was really for me, right? Because I knew like when I would post it, that's me like just checking in with myself. And then before you know it, like there was other people who jumped on the same bandwagon. So sometimes you got to be your own accountability partner and just establish something you're going to do to put yourself out there, right? And that becomes your own little game that you play. So whatever it is you're trying to accomplish that you're procrastinating on, just start putting it out there.
Because I think it's very, very important to be true to yourself first and then to others.
Yeah.
And I think there's no better way to do
that. Yep. They all work. And even if you want me to be your accountability partner, hit me up. You could just text me whatever it is you're trying to do, right? Yeah, it's like sometimes it could be that simple. It's like, hey, is it okay if every Friday I just text you like, hey, this is what I said I was gonna do, this is what I did. Mm-hmm.
I think
like that's very simple, right?
Yeah, and I think a lot of times, you know, we will let ourselves down, but we won't let other people down, yep. Right? So it's important that you get other people involved that can support you.
And that's the challenge, guys, with being self-employed, right? The challenge is there's no one freaking calling you out, right? There's no one saying, hey, you didn't make your calls. I mean, there's certain things you could, you know, put in place, and that's why being on a team is really powerful, or some form of a team where there's other people that you got to check in with, because it helps keep you accountable. But the great thing about being self-employed is that you're self-employed and you can set your own schedule. That's also the worst thing, right? Is that you can set your own schedule. And if you're not disciplined, you're not going to show up and make it happen. So like, if we already know that going in, then why not like try to play this game with ourselves or put things in place that are going to keep us on track, right? It's like, we got to put those things in place. You know, I know you, like every day you go to the gym, you tag, like you're tagging a lot of people now, right? You tag me too. And I didn't even know I was part of it, but why do you do that?
Because it holds me accountable too, right? And then I got Steve calling me, I got Robert going back,
yeah,
and we start all doing it. And it motivates other people. And when you can motivate other people, it also motivates yourself.
Yep.
And
then keeps you consistent. Keeps you consistent. I got Steve tagging me every time he's at the gym, you know, and it's like, then I'm cheering him on. Yeah, hell yeah, bro, let's go, you know? So it's.
And then even if you didn't want to do it that way, you got Steve there, like, shit, I better do it
too. Yeah, so exactly.
You all got to kind of. And I think that's, if you need an accountability partner in this room, you can definitely find it.
Yeah.
Right. In every aspect of your life, you can definitely find some type of accountability partner. And again, we've done challenges. I've been accountability partners with a handful of people here, and we, you know, we'll celebrate after we've completed, you know, that challenge.
Yeah. And it's up to you to make the rules, right? Play the game how you want to play the game. What you think is going to motivate you, because everyone has a different motivation. Some people are motivated by prizes and celebrations. Some people are motivated by like not having to deal with pain or something like that, right? So you got to each their own. But if you're the person that likes to celebrate, well, then put a celebration. Like Lily said, hey, if I do this, I'm going on vacation. That's her own little game that she's playing, you know? So it works, guys. This stuff works. This concludes the business planning part, guys. I really hope you guys got some value out of this today. What I can tell you guys is that this sheet, I want everyone to hold up their sheet. Everyone just hold it up, right? I want you to see how simple this is. It's a one-page sheet, right? We call it the one-page business plan, the VTO, vision, traction, organizer. That's where it comes from. But this literally right here, like you can go back and refine it, and I'll send you guys a link to a blank copy if you guys want to print it out and, you know, laminate it or whatever. But this is literally something that you can keep with you at all times, right? And when you get derailed, like you have to check in with yourself. So part of a well-executed business plan, guys, it's not just coming up with the plan. It's what you do after with this plan, right? You have to check in with yourself, because otherwise, like you just attended a seminar today, right? You watch a great YouTube video and you don't do anything. You just watch TV. That's basically what you do on your phone, right? On your cell phone. But part of it is taking this plan now, and every month you check in with yourself or with your team, right? Or with your leader or whoever it might be, or with your spouse, whoever is holding you accountable. You have to check in. Am I on track? Am I doing the things that I said I was going to do? Do I need to make some adjustments, right? So this also is something that can evolve and you make adjustments. But going at this business, guys, without a plan is you're setting up yourself for failure. That's just the bottom line. You need to have a plan. Nothing great is going to be built by just winging it. Winging it will get you. So there's a lot of talented individuals. Winging it got us really far for a long time, like, you know, making, closing consistent deals. But we were always capped and limited on our growth until we actually started putting a business plan together, till we started doing coaching at a high level, till we started holding ourselves accountable with people. That's when we saw our business explode. So I encourage all of you guys to like really take this serious. Don't just leave from this room with like, yeah, that was cool, you know, because that happens. You know what I mean? It's like, go back and put this somewhere where it's going to be in front of you and like play the game with yourself, right? Like if you know, like if I put it in my briefcase, guys, it's probably just going to stay in there and collect dust. Like I got to put this like by the coffee machine because I make coffee every morning, right? I got to put it on my mirror, like put it somewhere, make it your screensaver. So you know what, you know, what your tendencies are, but build that habit, put it somewhere where you're going to constantly be reminded. And I would also like to challenge all of you guys to check in with me in a month from now. Just check in, even if it's a call, even if you book a Zoom meeting with me or whatever it might be. It's like, hey, there's that plan. This is what I've done so far. Or these are the things that I've already started to work on. Or these are the things that I've put in place. That's the next step, guys. This is really just the first step. Any questions, guys? Comments, feedback? You guys hungry?
Ready for tacos.